Good day, everyone. So this is the final lecture of PILP 4019, Karoo Biostratigraphy. And today, we are going to finish what we started yesterday, which is the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zones and the subsequent zones up to the Jurassic. So last time I forgot to remind you, but as usual, take notes and download this video. Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. So what is that assemblage zone? It's the assemblage zone in purple on that map. And you can see that here it's called the Kystecephalus assemblage zone, not the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. But this name was just changed with the upcoming paper in June. So actually, as I'm talking now, I'm not even sure that it will be called Ola Cephalodon zone or Kystecephalus zone. I think they will go for Ola Cephalodon because Ola Cephalodon is the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone is the total range zone of this dicynodont, which is called Ola Cephalodon. So it would be logical to call it Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. The problem is that we recently discovered that Kystecephalus actually carries on in the next assemblage zone. So it doesn't die. At the end of the assemblage zone. So it would be more clever to call it the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. And in the past, that assemblage zone was called at some point the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. So I'm 80% sure that the new name will be Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. But just in case, you know that Kystecephalus assemblage zone may be another possible name for that assemblage zone. So it corresponds to the middle of the late Permian, to about 256 million years ago. If I give you about 256, it's because we don't have a lot of dates on the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zones for a simple reason. It's that it hasn't been studied that much in the last 30 years. People have been focusing a lot on the Permian-Triassic boundary, so on the Daptocephalus zone and Lystrosaurus zone. They have been focusing a lot. John Hancock have been focusing a lot on the Cynognathus zone, and Jonah and Aimé Chebordy on the next zone, the Massospondylus zone. Bruce and Mike, they have been busy with the Tapinocephalus zone and the Pristerognathus and the Tropidostoma zone, which leaves the Kystecephalus / Ola Cephalodon zone all alone without anyone to study it. So this is being repaired at the moment because there is a big project on the Ola Cephalodon zone carried on by Roger Smith and Claire Browning from the EZCO Museum. But for now, there's not much people working on the Ola Cephalodon zone. So that's why we don't have many dates. So we know it's about 250 million years. So it corresponds roughly to the Hudberg member of the Balfour Formation, and it's characterized by the presence of Ola Cephalodon. In general, it's the first biozone where you find a lot of large body sized dicynodont. You already have large body sized dicynodont in the Endothiodon assemblage zone, because Endothiodon itself is a big dicynodont. But really, the moment where the dicynodont become the dominant herbivore is really the Ola Cephalodon assemblage zone. So Ola Cephalodon is one of those big dicynodonts, very big temporal fenestra. And remember, it's the one I told you is a grazer because it has a squared snout. In addition to that, Ola Cephalodon is easily recognizable because of its horn. You can see the nasal horns are very prominent in that animal. So short snout with big horns or bosses on the side of the snout, that's an Ola Cephalodon. And Cystecephalus is nevertheless still an interesting stratigraphic marker of the Holacephalodon zone because it's abundant in the Holacephalodon zone, whereas in the next biozone, it's not that abundant, and actually it's very scarce. So, but in the Holacephalodon zone, you find a lot of Cystecephalus, which is this tiny dicynodont with its very broad intertemporal space. Cystecephalus means cephalus is the head, and cyste is the box. So it's really like it's shaped like a tiny box, and you can see it's a very cute little animal, Cystecephalus. Another interesting phenomenon that happens during the Holacephalodon is that Udinodon becomes the dominant relatively small-sized to medium-sized dicynodont compared to Dictyodon. So remember, Dictyodon is extremely abundant, like stupidly abundant in the Tropidostoma Gorgonops assembly subzone, well, in the Endosteiodon assemblage zone in general, but particularly in the Tropidostoma and the Lycosuchus subzones. But after that, in the Holacephalodon assemblage zone, the Dictyodon is replaced by Udinodon. And Udinodon is very different from Dictyodon because it doesn't have the 90 degree angle, and Udinodon never has a canine. So it never has a tusk, but unlike Endosteiodon, it has a maxillary process. It has the caniniform process of the maxilla. And the intertemporal is a bit broader also than Dictyodon. And Udinodon is also larger in average. And also that's the beginning of the Rubigene Gorgonopsian. So the Rubigene Gorgonopsians are the big one, very robust one with the pachyostotic supraorbital boss, supraorbital rim, with the pachyostotic postorbital bar, with the big flange on the side of the skull. So that's your Rubigene Gorgonopsian, and they become really important elements of the fauna at that time. So they become the Gorgonopsians in general are more abundant in Holacephalodon zone and the next zone. And in the rest of the world, we don't find Holacephalodon, but we do find a lot of Cystecephalid. For example, Cowinghasaurus from Zambia, your Cystecephalid with a very tiny eye and a very robust humerus with the big deltopectoral crest. And you have Sauroscaptor, which is definitely a Cystecephalid based on the broad, very broad box-shaped intertemporal. So these two indicate that Zambia and India, there are layers in Zambia and India that can be correlated to the Holacephalodon assemblage zone. The last zone of the Permian is the Daptocephalus assemblage zone. So Daptocephalus assemblage zone is what used to be called the Dicynodon assemblage zone. So it's the blue assemblage zone here. And maybe I should put an arrow like I did for the Cystecephalus assemblage zone, so that you know exactly what we are talking about on that slide. So Daptocephalus assemblage zone, about 250 to 252 million years ago. So it starts 250 million years ago, and we do have a date for this one, and it ends 252 million years ago with the Permian-Triassic boundary. So it's one of the few biozone limit that is meaningful in terms of biological event. It roughly corresponds to the Balfour, to the upper side of the Balfour Formation, and the Upper Tikloof and Normandian Formation. So the problem of the Daptocephalus zone is that it's located in areas in which the geological formations are not named the same, because they are very different. They are lithologically very different. So in the western part of the basin, it's called the Balfour Formation, if I'm not mistaken. And in the eastern part of the basin, it's called the Upper Tikloof formation, and I'm not even sure what the Normandian formation is, but but the idea is that lithologically you have very different types of formations, and yet you find the same fauna. So that's why you need biostratigraphy to correlate those formations. And so before it was called the Dicynodon assemblage zone, because we thought that these two species were actually the same, that Dicynodon and Daptocephalus were actually the same, because they are very similar to each other. But then there was a revision of the genus Dicynodon in 2011. And they found that actually Dicynodon can be distinguished from Daptocephalus because its eyes are facing forward and the intertemporal space is broader. So you can see the sagittal crest is a little broader in Dicynodon than in Daptocephalus. And in general, the skull of Daptocephalus is narrower. So you have a narrow palate, narrow temporal region, and the eyes are facing sideways. So Daptocephalus looks like laterally deformed Dicynodon. That also doesn't help identification, because sometimes you do find Dicynodon skull that have been squished. So having Daptocephalus looking like a squished Dicynodon doesn't help, but yeah. So, and the problem is also that Dicynodon appears in the Kystecephalus assemblage zone. So whereas Daptocephalus corresponds to the complete range of the Daptocephalus assemblage zone. So it's the total range of Daptocephalus. So yeah. And itself, the Daptocephalus zone has been divided into two subzones, which were before the new revised biostratigraphy, they were called the upper tap zone and the upper Daptocephalus zone and the lower Daptocephalus zone. So the lower Daptocephalus zone is subzone is now called the Dicynodont Theriognatus assemblage zone. So you can see Dicynodon starts in the Kystecephalus zone and ends at the end of the lower Daptocephalus zone. And it is accompanied by your Theriognatus. So remember, Theriognatus is the therocephalian that doesn't have postcanine teeth at all, and it's a relatively large therocephalian. The skull is about that size. Dicynodon and Daptocephalus, by the way, are almost also the same size. The skull is about that size too. So that also doesn't help to distinguish Dicynodon from Daptocephalus. Another fossil that is typical of the lower Daptocephalus zone is Procynosuchus, the basal cynodont, the one that has the two lumps of the maxilla that are not connected yet. So that doesn't form the secondary palate yet. So that's why you find it also in the lower Daptocephalus zone. But same thing, they are not completely typical of the lower Daptocephalus zone. So really the only one that you find only in the lower Daptocephalus zone is Theriognatus. So the large therocephalian without any postcanine teeth. And it's a white seed, so you can see it doesn't have a complete secondary palate. And the upper Daptocephalus zone corresponds now to the Lystrosaurus mackayi and Moschorhinus subzone. So it's fairly easy to recognize. So first, it's the total subzone of Lystrosaurus mackayi, and Lystrosaurus mackayi is very easy to identify. It's the super big Lystrosaurus. So the skull is about that size, whereas the other Lystrosaurus, the skull is about that size. So they are very different. The Lystrosaurus mackayi is very different from the other Lystrosauruses. So very easy to identify. Also, you can see that it has a sharply bended snout, 90 degrees angle, and you can see there are horns or bosses on top of the orbits that are usually, if not absent, at least smaller in other species of Lystrosaurus. And you have also Moscorinus, but Moscorinus carries on a little bit after the Permian-Triassic boundary, so it's a decent indicator. Well, actually, Moscorinus, you can see the big problem is that you also find it in the lower Daptocephalus zone. So Moscorinus is not a very good indicator. It's a good indicator of the Daptocephalus zone in general, and not as good as Daptocephalus itself, because first, it's a carnivore, so you don't find that much of them. And second, they carry on in the after the Permian-Triassic boundary just a little bit, so that doesn't help. But the fossil is quite recognizable because it's a therocephalian, so you can see the fenestra on the ventral side, the suborbital vacuity on the palate, and on the top, you can see the snout is very short and very broad, so it's unique for this character. And we have also different cases of correlation of the Daptocephalus zone with other parts of the world, noticeably in Europe when you find Dicynodon, like in Scotland, and you also find Dicynodon in Russia. So the genus itself, Dicynodon, is has a worldwide distribution. So now, at the end of the Daptocephalus zone, we reach an important event, which is the PT boundary, the Permian-Triassic boundary, or the end Permian extinction. So as you can see, this Permian extinction was not a very sharp event in the Karoo. It was not as sharp as in the sea. In the sea, you really see a line, foraminiferan going extinct and invertebrates going extinct and new invertebrates replacing them. On land, Roger Smith probably told you that it's a four-stepped event. So there are four extinction events that are succeeding each other. But for the purpose of biostratigraphy, what's going to tell you that you're looking at a PT boundary is to find Lystrosaurus curvatus, which is really the species that thrived during the extinction. It's the species that originate at the onset of the extinction and dies after the end of the extinction event. So it's what we call a disaster species. A disaster species is a species that thrives during mass extinction events. So probably humans are a disaster species, but who am I to judge? But if you look for a good example of disaster species, human beings can be one of them. So the PT boundary is marked first by the disappearance of Lystrosaurus makegai. So the big Lystrosaurus, which is replaced by smaller sized Lystrosaurus, such as Curvatus and later Declivis. And you really see the gradient of smaller size, by the way. Like Curvatus is slightly smaller than Makegai, and Declivis is again smaller than Curvatus. So that's what we call the Lilliput effect, the shrinking of body size across a mass extinction event. Also, there is a change in the... You can also find your PT boundary by looking at a change in the flora. So before the PT boundary, the flora is dominated by Glossopteris, and after, it's dominated by the fern-like Dicroidium. Also, the PT boundary also corresponds to the origin of the first archosaurs. So before the PT boundary, there is no archosaurs, but then at the very onset of the PT boundary, you have the first Proterozoicus. So the first archosaurs, so that's, by the way, is not Proterozoicus. I've just realized that's Archosaurus, but they look similar enough. I will change that for the PDF, so that you have the proper Proterozoicus, that's Archosaurus. But yeah, they are the same in the way that they have that overhanging premaxilla that is very, very distinctive. So Proterozoicus is your archosaur from the PT boundary. And you have also a change in the preservation type of the fossils. In the Permian, your fossils are usually preserved in green nodules, and in the Triassic, your fossils are usually preserved in red nodules. So here I have increased the saturation just to, so that you can see the red color and the green color. And this change in color is due to a change in the oxidization of the iron. So here the iron is reduced, which is indicative of a swampy area where there is a few oxygen where the fossils are formed. And here the iron is oxidated, so it's rusty. It's rusty, that's why it is red. And this is due to more oxygen in the deposition environment, probably due to the change also that Roger told you about, the change in the water regime. So in the Permian, you have rivers that are really meandering and creating swamps, and you have inundation plains around those rivers. So it's a very moist area and there's very little oxygen in the soil. That's why your fossils have a reduced iron around them. But then after the PT boundary, the rivers become straighter, and so you have, it's a much less moist environment. So because of that, and because of that, the waters are more oxygenated and the soil is more oxygenated, so the fossils are in this rusty crust. And you still find these fossils in the rusty crust up until the Jurassic. So it's called the hematite, by the way, that rusty crust that you find around the fossil. And it's a nightmare when you want to CT scan your fossils. So this leads us to the early Triassic with the Lystrosaurus declivis assemblage zone. So Lystrosaurus declivis corresponds to the former Lystrosaurus assemblage zone. So it's the light green zone here. So it's also quite a big one. And you see that we are narrowing down. So the logic that I've told you at the beginning with the Dwaika, the Eka, and then the Permian and the Triassic and the Jurassic in the middle, this you can see here that you can also follow that logic through the assemblage zones. So with the Tapinocephalus first, and then the Pristerognathus and the Tropi and the Andosiodon, the Daptocephalus, it's really narrowing toward the Drakensberg, toward the Lesotho. So Lystrosaurus declivis is really easy to identify because it's like a Lystrosaurus makegai, but in smaller, and it doesn't have the boss, or the boss on top of the orbit are smaller. So it's quite easy to identify. The Lystrosaurus declivis assemblage zone corresponds to the complete range, the total range of Lystrosaurus declivis. So it's a very convenient assemblage zone. It roughly corresponds to the Katberg formation. It starts at about 252 million years, and we don't know exactly where it stops. And there's probably a gap, a fossilization gap between the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone and the next assemblage zone. So there was probably an unconformity, which means that there was no deposit, or the deposits were eroded between the two assemblage zones. It's characterized by the presence and abundance of Lystrosaurus declivis. There is also another species of Lystrosaurus that is present in this assemblage zone, Lystrosaurus murrayi. So in general, it's defined by the extraordinary abundance of Lystrosaurus. There are Lystrosauruses everywhere, like the very similar to the Dictyodons in the Andothiodon assemblage zones. So last year, for example, we were at the Oviston Nature Reserve with the owners in November, and we found no less than maybe 20 skull or skeletons of Lystrosaurus in just one day of work. So that it tells you how many Lystrosauruses you can find in the Triassic. And two other important taxa that are found in the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone, Trinaxodon, Trinaxodon, which is quite abundant. It's your basal cynodont with a complete secondary palate and the tricuspid teeth. And cynodonts in general are quite abundant. So same thing. Last year, during the same trip, in just one day, we found no less than three cynodonts. At least two of them being most probably Trinaxodon. So that also tells you that you're looking at the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone. And Procolophon. Does not appear right at the beginning of the assemblage zone. It appears a bit later, but it's also typical of the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone. It is very easily recognizable with its very large oval-looking orbit, the big pineal foramen, and the horn and the teeth that are broad and comfortant. And worldwide, Lystrosaurus has been found in India and in Antarctica. So there's the story of James Kitching. I probably told you already. There's that story of James Kitching, first paleontologist to go in Antarctica to look for fossils. He is in the helicopter on. Just flying over a mountain that will be called the Kitching Mountain. It's not yet called the Kitching Mountain at that time, but it will be called the Kitching Mountain. And so he's flying in the helicopter and he sees an outcrop, tells the pilot to land there, go off the helicopter, and come back 10 minutes later with a Lystrosaurus. So that's. That's the story of James Kitching in Antarctica. So, and that's the story of the discovery of the first Lystrosaurus in Antarctica, and many more have been found. So we know that there is a Triassic deposit equivalent to the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone in Antarctica because of that. And there are also Lystrosauruses in India. So we know that the three areas are the same age and were connected through Gondwana land. And same thing for Trinaxodon. Trinaxodon was found, and Procolophon too. The next assemblage zone is the Cynognathus assemblage zone. So this hasn't changed name, so it's the dark green one here. In the Cynognathus assemblage zone, so the Cynognathus assemblage zone is quite time extensive. So first, it starts 235 million years ago and ends 243 million years ago. So it's almost 10 million years long. So it's almost as long as the Tapinocephalus assemblage zone. It corresponds to the whole Burgerdorps formation, and the Burgerdorps formation is discordant over the previous formation, the Kapberg formation. So in between, there is an erosion surface. So as I told you, we are lacking a slice of time in between. So that's why I told you we don't know exactly when the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone end. But that interval of time was probably not that big because the Cynognathus assemblage zone is dated from the Middle Permian. Whereas the Kapberg, the Lystrosaurus formation is from the early Permian, the early Triassic, sorry. No, of course, not Permian, Triassic. The Cynognathus assemblage zone is defined by the presence of the Cynognathia. So if you remember, the Cynognathia are the cynodont with the W shape occiput. So you have Cynognathus, which was the carnivorous species, and you have Diadymodon, which belongs to the gonfodont cynodonts, which is all the other Cynognathian cynodonts. And Diadymodon is probably the most abundant of them all. So Diadymodon is recognizable because it doesn't have a diastema yet, and it still retains some sectorial teeth at the back. So that's how you recognize your Diadymodon. And you can see that the size is comparable to that of Cynognathus. So it's quite a big animal, actually. The skull is about that size. And the Cynognathus assemblage zone is also identified by its abundance of temnospondyls, So the amphibians with the big interpterygoid vacuities, that's where they are mostly found. There are some temnospondyls in the Permian, but they all belong to the Rhynesuchid, if not to Rhynesuchus only. So it's a very low diversity of temnospondyls in the Permian. But suddenly, after the PT boundary, and particularly during the Synognathus assemblage zone, they become much more abundant. So if you find an amphibian, and particularly a temnospondyl, you're probably looking in all. And it's really a statistical approach. Like statistically, you have more chance to be looking at the Synognathus assemblage zone. But the best way to demonstrate it is to find those guys, the Synognathians, with their W-shaped occiput and their squamosal flange here on the side. And the last group that is only found in the that appears in the Synognathus assemblage zone is the Kahnmeyeriform, but we will see that they are not only found in the Synognathus assemblage zone, and this was demonstrated quite recently, actually. So, but there are, yeah, and that's the Kahnmeyeriform. So the one dicynodonts that are usually quite big, with a very high sagittal crest, and the pineal foramen that is pushed forward from the sagittal crest and forms a funnel. So it's funnel shaped. And the very broad also nasal because of the boss, and the very broad rostrum because of the very big overdeveloped caniniform process. So you can see here, you have a nice view of Kahnmeyeria. You can really see that the snout is much broader than the frontal region. So that's a good defining feature of Kahnmeyeriforms. And the Synognathus assemblage zone has been correlated with many, many, many places in the world because first there is a lot of deposits around the world that date from the Middle Triassic, compared to, for example, the Early Triassic. The Early Triassic is much less well represented, but the Middle Triassic is very, very well represented. And we find Kahnmeyeriforms in all these deposits. So you have Placerias in North America, Ishigualastia, in South America. So you can see very high sagittal crest, funnel-shaped pineal foramen, broad snout, and Paracanmeyeria in China. So and you can see these are among the largest dicynodont ever found. And by the way, the largest dicynodont ever found. And the largest non-mammalian therapsid in general is a Kahnmeyeriform, and its name is Lizowickia from Poland. So maybe I can show you Lizowickia. Mm-hmm. I can Google that for you right now. So this is the skeleton of Lizowickia. So you can see it's definitely a Kahnmeyeriform, from the sagittal crest and the big size of the caniniform process. But you can see it's a very, very, very big animal. And it's the largest non-mammalian therapsid. I say non-mammalian because elephants are still bigger than it. The Synognathus assemblage zone has been historically divided into three biozones. Into three subzones, and maybe I will give you this as a way to help you. The first subzone was subzone A, the second subzone was subzone B, and the third subzone was subzone C. And now they have been, with the new paper coming out, the new papers coming out in June, these subzones have been renamed with a double name, because that's what you're supposed to do for subzones. You're not supposed to give them letters, you're supposed to give them a binomial name So yeah, that's not very convenient because it was much easier to remember ABC. And I won't blame you if you remember ABC. So, subzone A, now renamed Langberger-Gargeina subzone. So remember Gargeina, that's the archosaur that was named after Nelson Mandela, Gargeina Madiba. So the subzone A is distinct because it has no dicynodont and it has boreamorphs. So boreamorphs, if you remember, that's the therocephalians that are the most derived because they have that complete secondary palate in which the vomer plays no role anymore. So it's only the maxilla and a bit of the palatine that participates to the secondary palate. And they are herbivorous. So when you look at the teeth are gomphodont. They are expanded laterally, just like in Cynognathians, in the gomphodont Cynognathians. So they look very similar to gomphodont Cynognathians in many respects. You can see the incisors are very big. So the heterodonty is very well marked in boreamorphs. And here you can see it's a borea because borea doesn't have a pineal foramen. And you have another species which is Microgomphodon. It's exactly like borea, but it does have a pineal foramen. So the two species are distinguished by their pineal foramen. Subzone B, you have boreamorphs and you have Kenmeyeriformes, particularly Kenmeyeria, and that's why it's called the Triracodon Kenmeyeria assembly subzone because you have Kenmeyeria in it. So and it's distinguished from the third subzone C, which is the subzone in which you find Kenmeyeriformes but you don't find boreamorphs. So here you have boreamorphs. Boreamorphs appears. Kenmeyeriformes appears, boreamorphs disappears, but the Kenmeyeriformes are still there. So you have that gradient. So we are typically looking at the serial subzonation of the Cynognathus assembly zone. Just as I was saying, I won't mind if you don't remember the Langberger-Gargeina, because Langberger, Triracodon, and Cricodon, they are typical of these subzones, but they are so difficult to distinguish from each other if you don't know. Same thing, if you are not a specialist, it's very difficult to differentiate Ufudocyclops from a Kenmeyeria. So I won't blame you to not be able to remember those things. Subzone ABC is good enough. So the next is the Molteno formation, and it's not an assemblage zone because we don't find any fossil. Well, we don't find any vertebrate fossil, at least. The only vertebrate fossil that you find in the Molteno formation is dinosaur footprints, like those typical three fingers dinosaur footprints. The rest is plant material, very abundant and very well preserved. Plant material, must I say. Here you have magnificent ginkgo, for example, the leaf of a beautiful ginkgo. And you have beautiful insects also. And you have beautiful marks of insects on plants. So you can see that that plants were eaten away by insects. So, but the Molteno formation has no assemblage zone because there's no vertebrate fossil. But it's recognizable still because it's very. It's a very reddish brown color, and you have those dinosaur footprints. So dinosaur footprints are not only found in the Molteno formation, but they are mostly found in the Molteno formation, and it's correlated to the Middle Triassic, to early late, sorry, not Triassic, Jurassic, to the early late Jurassic. But we don't have much dates for the Molteno formation. So the next assemblage zone is located in the Elliott and Clara. It's located in the Elliott formation, and it corresponds to the lower Elliott formation, 210 to 200 million years. It's the upper Triassic. So it's the it corresponds to the very end of the Triassic, because 200 million years ago, that's the beginning of the Jurassic. So the Lower Elliot Formation has a unique content of fossils made of some rare Cadmeyeri forms like Pentasaurus, mostly very small cynodont like Pachygenlus. Pachygenlus is a close relative of Diarthrognathus. If you remember the slides on the slide on Diarthrognathus, Pachygenlus is in much aspects quite identical to Diarthrognathus, but Pachygenlus is more common. And you find, and this assemblage zone gets its name from Scalenodontoides. So this is Scalenodontoides, that's a palatine view, so it's the view of the palate. And you can see it as very broad gomphodont teeth, very pointy, very sharp, sharp squamosal flange. And here is the canine. So here you have no diastema between here is the canine, and here you have a diastema, and here you have the beginning of the gomphodont postcanine teeth. So you have a diastema and large gomphodont teeth. It means that you're looking at a very, very derived traversodontid synognathian. So actually, I should, instead of saying traversodontid are gomphodont, but not all gomphodonts are traversodontid. So I should say here that you have the most derived traversodontid synognathian. So it's almost Scalenodontoides is almost identical to Exoeratodon. If you remember the class on the evolution of cynodonts, you can go back there and check that Scalenodontoides is very, very closely related to Exoeratodon. So big canine, diastema, gonfodon dentition, pointy squamosal flange, that's a very derived synognathian, traversodontid. And also you have very few dinosaurs in the Scalenodontoid assemblage zone. So it's not perfectly well defined, but it's a very new assemblage zone too. That assemblage zone was created for those papers that are coming out in June. So it's a very, very new assemblage zone. It did not exist before. So that's why the fossils there are not superbly, that's why the fossil content of that assemblage zone is not superbly well defined, and it's probably going to change a bit in the next few years now that it has been clearly defined. And what's interesting now is that you can correlate this assemblage zone to the assemblage zone in which you find Exoeratodon. So there is an I kind of remember there was a zone that was named after. So here they have a pro. You can see in South. This is from Brazil, by the way. I should start from the beginning, before anything. So this is the assemblage zones that they use in Brazil, and you can see that they have a procolophon assemblage zone, which is equivalent to the Lystrosaurus assemblage zone in South Africa. And they have Exoeratodon, that should be. So you have all the Probenognathians that are very similar to Pachygenlus that are used for biozonation. So particularly Prosostrodon is quite close to Pachygenlus. So that would correspond roughly to the Hyperoodapedon assemblage zone. And Exoeratodon, I thought Exoeratodon was there, but unfortunately it's not, but it should be also in the Hyperoodapedon assemblage zone. And the final assemblage zone is the Massospondylus assemblage zone. That one is very clearly defined. It corresponds to the Upper Elliot Formation and the Clarence Formation. So it's the beginning, the very beginning of the Jurassic. So between the Lower and Upper Elliot, you have another mass extinction, the Triassic-Jurassic mass extinction, another on, of the big five mass extinction. So in this assemblage zone, you have a lot of dinosaurs, particularly Massospondylus, so prosauropod Massospondylus, and very recognizable by its lanceolate teeth. And you have a Syntarsus megatnosaurus, the theropod, the small theropod from the early Jurassic. And this is also in the Upper Elliot and Clarence Formation, that you, particularly in the Upper Elliot, that you find Tritylodon. And once upon a time, there used to be a Tritylodon acme zone right in the middle of the Upper Elliot Formation. So there used to be an acme zone of Tritylodon right in the middle of the Upper Elliot. But now Tritylodon has been found all throughout the Massospondylus assemblage zone. So Tritylodon is also a typical fossil. And it's very easy to identify because of its teeth, the three rows of teeth, of postcanine teeth, plus the rodent-like incisors. So here is, for example, how you correlate the Massospondylus assemblage zone in the rest of the world. So in Europe, we find Plateosaurus, which is like a long-snouted version of Massospondylus. In China, they have Lufengosaurus, and in Argentina, they have Musaurus and Leonerasaurus, which are also all prosauropods. So there are prosauropods all around the world, and they can be correlated to the Massospondylus assemblage zone. So to conclude, I've already quite insisted a lot on how the assemblage zone system, the Karoo assemblage zone system, has been generalized in the rest of the world, and how you can correlate layers geological layers around the world with the Karoo using the fossils. But I can show you a few examples of how the I just want to show you a few examples of how the that biozonation, that Karoo biozonation, serve as a basis for biozonation everywhere in the world. So here, for example, you can see deposits in Zambia, in Tanzania. That's in Omigonde Formation. It's in Namibia. So the Burgersdorp is in South Africa. So that's your typical Karoo subzonation. And here you have the Santa Maria Formation in that's what I was talking about just before, in Brazil. So, and you can see that the Karoo has served as a basis to correlate all these layers from around Africa and South America. And particularly, you find Cynognathus from the Cynognathus zone everywhere in those layers. And you find Cadmeyeriformes such as Angonisaurus, for example. Angonisaurus is a Cadmeyeriform. You find it. And you have Stalkeria. Stalkeria is another Cadmeyeriform in the next subzone. So here, that will be a subzone. Here you have two subzones with Cadmeyeriform. So it's probably the subzone B and subzone C. And you find also cynodonts like Luangua. So many, many species are common to many basins, even all the way to South America, like Langua is also found in South America, and Cynognathus and Diadimodon. So it's not only, it doesn't work only on the Karoo, it works everywhere. Here you have again Zambia and Tanzania that are correlated. So they found also a way to correlate lower layers to the Kistecephalus, so now the Holacephalodon assemblage zone. It's because of the presence of Cowinghasaurus, for example. And in North America, they also use the same thing. So they have their own biozones based on an amphibian called Eriops, and on the pelicosaur called Sphenacodon, and on another amphibian called Semuria. And they also use smaller biozones, especially for the end of the Permian, Micterosaurus, which is Varanopid, Labidosaurus, Angelosaurus. These have no idea. They are probably pelicosaurs. And in China, you can see the biozonation in China is also mirrored on the It also mirrors the biozonation in South Africa. So you have the Cynophoneus assemblage zone, which is roughly equivalent to the Iodicynodon assemblage zone, because Cynophoneus looks very much like Australosiodon. You have the Turfanodon assemblage zone, which corresponds to most of the the middle and late Permian. So it's not extremely helpful, but that works. They have a Lystrosaurus assemblage zone, just like us. They found some Lystrosaurus in China. And then you have the equivalent of the Cynognathus assemblage zone with their Kenmeyeri forms, their local Kenmeyeri forms, Cyno-Kenmeyeria and Shambai Kenmeyeria. So you see that and Xiyu Kenmeyeria. And you see they also try to correlate different parts of their basins. So it's not just the South African way of doing biozonation that is being exported, it's also being personalized after that. So they mirror their biozonation to the South African one, and then they apply it to the different parts of their basins to correlate these different parts of the basins with each other. And that's quite amazing how they can achieve doing that. In Europe, there is not too much therapsids, but we do have a lot of amphibians. So they use amphibians to correlate their Permian and Carboniferous layers. And in Russia now, they have a lot of biozonation systems that were developed in parallel to the South African one that was developed particularly during the Cold War. So they did not want during the Cold War to use the same biozonation system as the Western countries. But once the Cold War was over, you can see the system was developed in 1937. The first biozonation system was developed in 1937. You had zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, zone 4. That's So it was based on biozonation, but it was not very clear what they were doing. It was not very transparent. But after the Cold War, Ivanchenko redid the complete biozonation by copying the biozonation system in South Africa. And now you have the Titanophoneus superzone, which is equivalent to the it's equivalent to the Tapinocephalus assemblage zone, and you have the Scutosaurus superzone, which is equivalent to the late Permian, and which itself, so Scutosaurus is a derived pariasaur, so it's one of those pariasaurs that has a lot of scutes on its back, and it hence its name Scutosaurus. So it has all those scutes on its back. So it's a late Permian pariasaur. And Titanophoneus is an anteosaurid dinocephalian. So that's why I say it's equivalent to the Tapinocephalus assemblage zone. And this system has been readapted into another type of assemblage zone. So once again, they use the dinocephalian assemblage. So now they use Dinocephalian assemblage zone, super assemblage, and they have a Theriodontia assemblage zone, which is the late Permian. So yeah, last idea in all the in everything. So I've insisted that this was a still work in progress quite sometimes during this, but I cannot insist enough that it's work in progress. It's constantly in progress. And every new fossil can push back in time or forward in time those the limits of this biozone. So here you have a summary of the history of those the South African biozonation since it was formalized for the first time by Broome. Actually, I think it was Seeley who also worked a previous system of biozonation even before Broome. So you can see it's very old and it has been reworked many, 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 many times. And this was the state of the biozonation that I was teaching still last year. And it dates from 1995. And now this is the new framework that I'm proposing to you. So Tropidostoma and Pristorinatus have been have been lumped into the endothyodont assemblage zone. Cystecephalus has become the holacephalodont assemblage zone. Dicynodon has become the daptocephalus. Lystrosaurus is now the Lystrosaurus declivis. And on top of that, you would have the Massospondylus, the Scalenodontoides, and Massospondylus assemblage zone that would come on top of that, but there's no space. So, and the Iodicynodon here at the bottom. So that's, yeah, it's work in progress all the time, and it will be work in progress all of the time, because as I said previously, at the beginning of that class, biozonation is made for convenience by researcher for researcher. So they can, these limits are prone to move. Okay, so that's it for the Karoo biostratigraphy class. That's a lot of work and a lot of information for you to process. So I wish you good luck and see you soon, I hope.